Good morning, everybody. I want to welcome you to Elim Life Church. Great to see you this morning. I've been able to greet most of you that have come in so far, and if I haven't, good morning to you. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Why don't we stand together this morning? I want to open us in prayer. And so thankful to have Miriam Morelli here leading us in worship today. That's a real blessing, and Mark's up here accompanying. Lord, we thank you today for your goodness. Thank you for your love. God, your word instructs us to come into your courts with thanksgiving, Lord, into your presence and into your courts, God, with praise and thanksgiving. And Lord, sometimes it's hard to reach in or reach out away from ourselves and our situations, but God, today, Lord, we look to you and we take this time to express thankfulness to you, to lift up our hearts and lift up our voices in worship, Lord, to honor and bless you, the Savior of the world. Amen. Let's worship the Lord together.
Water. the times we can feel it, and sense it and know it, and the times where it is so not clear, but your feet are planted firmly right next to ours, Lord. When everything around us says, you are not here, Father, you declare over this people, over us, over myself, that I am right with you. For the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. Oh, Jesus, we thank you, Lord, that we never have to walk alone. Not one more day will I walk alone, Jesus, because of your blood that washed over me. Thank you for your peace, Father, the peace that comes with your presence. You guys can stay standing, because we're not doing communion today. A short word on offering as we prepare. As you guys know, we've got our offering boxes on the sides of the sanctuary here, and you can give online, app, or the website. But I felt like the Lord wanted to remind us again today of his provision, his ability to come through for us. Psalm 24:1 says this, "The earth is the Lord's, and everything in it, the world and all who live in it, for he founded it on the seas and established it on the waters." I'm going to read this again. I just want you to repeat after me. You don't have to do it out loud. You can just think through the words, meditate on the words in your mind as I read this. I'll say the phrase. I'll pause. You can say the phrase out loud or just speak it into your heart until we finish this. The earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. The earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. As many of us might be giving already or still learning what it means, what the Lord is calling us to give of our life, of our finances, of our resources, whatever that looks like, whether you've been doing it a long time, you've never done it, or you're looking to do, you're just starting, the Lord is desiring to walk with you, to remind you of his goodness, his presence, his provision, that everything in the world is the Lord's. As you and your mind and as you plan out your life and as you do it with the Lord, there's never a moment in the future where God fumbles the ball and says, oh my gosh, I don't have enough for what you need. That moment never comes because he has access to everything you need. A famous missionary once said, the Lord's work done the Lord's way will never lack the Lord's supply. And so as you plan this life out, as you walk this life out, the Lord is wanting to remind you that he has everything you need. Everything you need. So as we give today, we think about giving our lives, giving our finances to the Lord, the master over our lives. Lord, we pray, take our lives and use them. Everything is yours, Lord. Everything I'll ever need, I will have because I know you. Jesus, I say it again from my own heart. Lord, everything I ever will need, Lord, you will come through and provide for me. I will never be in lack with you, Father. You carry us. You walk with us. You give me everything I need. Not so that somebody can receive provision, somebody can receive my finances, but so that you can show me your goodness, Lord. So that I can trust in your promises. So that I can walk in peace when everything around me is falling apart. Lord, we declare it, everything is yours. In Jesus' name. Let's continue to worship.
truly sense the Lord moving by His Spirit this morning, and I want us to take a moment. I feel the Lord's given me something to share with you today, and believing it's for more than one of you, but it may just be for one, and it certainly spoke to my heart. The image that came to my mind is holding a cup close to my chest and holding it close to my person to protect it, and kind of in a humorous way, the first thought I had was, you know, as a firstborn, I tend to have a collection of things that I like to protect, and I know if I share my favorite mug, for example, it'll probably end up broken or ruined. Is anybody with me on that? Maybe it's just a firstborn thing. But in the scripture, there is an image given where it's an analogy or a metaphor that our lives are like a cup. And without God, ultimately we find that they are empty, or at least the things that life can fill us up with, even the best things, only fill us so much, and they dry up quickly, and they leak, and they're lost. And life also brings things that are not the things we would ask for. And there's a tendency in life to want to draw in and protect ourselves and to draw back. And what happens often is we begin to do that with God. And we begin to withhold. If the cup is our life, we begin to withhold our lives. And it's not that we don't carry through in the outward things and the basic habits of even of the Christian life, that we go through the motions. But what the Lord would have us to do is, you know, David said in Psalm 23, He prepares a table before me in the presence of my enemies. And the amazing thing about that is that God's giving him great provisions, even in what seemed like the worst situation. And then David said, my cup overflows. And what God wants to do with our lives is he wants to fill us up, and he wants our lives to overflow in him. It doesn't mean always overflowing in the abundance of possessions or the prosperity of our practical lives, although at times those things come from the Lord, but really it has to do with the inner life, and God wants our lives to overflow. But the thing is that if we hold in protection ourselves and withhold trust from God, and we aren't willing to really extend what is so precious to us, and there's nothing more precious to us than our lives and our hearts and our soul, and to extend what we value so much. Maybe it's a person or a relationship we have. Maybe it's something that we're just holding, we're trying to protect. And until we really become more vulnerable and entrust ourselves to the Lord in that area, he's not going to force us. He's not going to force us to let him fill. The way it is with the Lord is he waits on us. And this morning I want to invite you. I just sense the Lord begin to move so powerfully here today. I want to invite you to take a moment to entrust yourself to the Lord in a fresh way. And just where you are, you stand or sit, and then I'm going to ask Miriam if she could just lead us through that chorus again to finish out our time of worship and song. And just begin to entrust yourself and just express to the Lord with your own words. You can do it out loud. This is a place where you can pray out loud, and there's nothing unusual about that. Certainly not. You can do that in the quietness of your heart and mind. Maybe you want to kneel. You can stand. You can sit. I just want us to take maybe 30 seconds this morning and say, Lord, I'm entrusting myself to you again fully. I'm taking off the protections. I'm taking off the barriers and the boundaries that I placed around my heart that have ended up preventing me from being fully open to you and what you want to bring into my life. Lord, you're a holy and awesome God, and you're a loving God who's full of mercy and compassion and kindness. Why would I ever want to protect myself from you, Lord? And so today I choose to trust you with the cup of my life, with what's near to my heart. Lord, with what is precious to me and what I value so much, those things in my life that I'm holding on to, God, I'm trusting them to you. Lord, if it's hurting me, if you're pulling, if you're wanting my hands to come out, if you're motioning to me and signaling that you want me to be more open, Lord, I trust you. Put my faith in you and your goodness, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Miriam, could you close us out with that chorus again?
Great and marvelous.
set our minds apart, Lord, not focusing on everything else going on in our relationships, work, at home. Lord, we connect with you, Lord. Strengthen us this week. Strengthen us every day, coming to you, spending time with you. Fill us with your Spirit, Lord, that we might live for you and be a light in our communities. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, most of you are seated, so feel free to relax for a moment. We've got a few announcements before we get into our intermission here, where you guys can grab some popcorn and get back to that fun. But the first announcement is, today is our Sunday Fun Day. You'll see our graphic up here in a minute. But the Brighton campus is pretty lucky because last week we had our potluck, and you guys get to have another opportunity to do another one this Sunday down in Lima. Our campuses are coming together down in Lima today, immediately after the services. There's going to be all these awesome things going on. Great food, some games, some bounce houses, the lawn games. You're going to be able to meet some other people from different campuses, interact, talk, get to know somebody. All good things. The address of our Lima campus, which feel free to grab me or Pastor Nathan after service, but it's 1679 Dalton Road, and you can find it pretty easily on Google Maps. But everyone is invited, whether you brought a meal or not. Go on out, enjoy some fun, and get some good food for sure. The second announcement, though, is that we have a new series coming up called Proverbs, Words to the Wise. We've had an awesome time in this series. I have, at least, eating some popcorn, watching some movies, but most of all, plugging into what God's saying and speaking into my life through the scriptures. And but we've got a new series coming up with a ton of wisdom, obviously, in Proverbs, so much to grab onto and to apply to our lives, of what the Lord is speaking in His specific situations, in our relationships, our same thing, our work, relationships, all these things that God wants to give you direction in. He wants to bless. He wants you to help live an abundant life in these situations. And so come on out. We're going to have a great time plugging in and digging into what He's saying to us there. But without further ado, we're going to take a break. You guys can stand up, say hi to somebody new, grab some popcorn, take a bathroom break, and we'll be back with the message.
Snack. Satisfy your hunger, your thirst, your sweet tooth. So visit our refreshment center now. Let's go! And now, intermission. Refreshment time.
See what I get from the refreshment counter. Oh boy, popcorn and candy bars and ice cream. And, oh, boy, sparkling, ice-cold Coca-Cola. Oh, boy, that tastes good. Have you been to the refreshment counter?
Remember, your favorite snack will taste especially good with world-famous ice-cold Coca-Cola.
Mr. Cal.
Yes?
How many licks does it take to get to the Tootsie Roll Center of a Tootsie Pop?
I don't know. I always end up biting. Ask Mr. Fox, for he's much cleverer than I.
Mr. Fox, how many licks does it take to get to the Tootsie Roll Center of a Tootsie Pop?
Why don't you ask Mr. Turtle, for he's been around a lot longer than I. Me? I bite.
Mr. Turtle, how many licks does it take to get to the Tootsie Roll Center of a Tootsie Pop?
Why, you never made it without biting. Ask Mr. Owl, for he is the wisest of us all.
Mr. Owl, how many licks does it take to get to the Tootsie Roll Center of a Tootsie Pop?
A good question. Let's find out. One, two, three.
If there's anything I can't stand, it's a smart owl.
How many licks does it take to get to the Tootsie Roll Center of a Tootsie Pop? The world may never know.
I'm sorry, sir. This is a private mountain.
But I only wanted it.
This mountain is reserved for patrons of drive-in theaters.
But it's
a supply depot for all sorts of good things, which people can get at the snack bar. Like soft drinks, hot dogs, good hot coffee, candy bars of all kinds, delicious popcorn, and refreshing ice cream treats.
But I am a patron of this drive-in.
Well, why didn't you say so? Be our guest.
What is it?
Say,
what is it?
Hey, why it's buttercup, popcorn and sweet cream butter, too hot popcorn. Mix it up, wrap it up.
It's delicious.
So nutritious.
It's a taste delight.
It's so munchy.
Crisp and crunchy.
You'll enjoy each bite. Eat butter drenched buttercup popcorn at its best.
Served in a king size cup.
It beats all the rest.
Gather back in, rally the troops here. beat a record here, get you guys seated in less than a minute. There we go. All right. Raise your hand if you have, like, a favorite pen. You go to get, you're writing something or doing some work, there's a favorite pen. Does anyone have a favorite pen? Okay, it's almost 50% of you. Well, I'll tell you what, if I had a favorite sheet of paper, this would probably be it right here, our New Here card. I love being able to talk about these New Here cards. Might be silly, but I'm actually very serious about it. These things, as simple as they are, for us, can be an awesome way to connect you into the community here, our family. We're the family of God. And so if you're new, or it's your second time, or your third time, or you've been here 6 months and you haven't said hi to anyone, fill this thing out. We'd love to connect with you, see how we can plug you into small groups, the young adult ministry, or meeting with men, you know, whatever the case is, we want to connect with you and get you plugged in. We will not spam you, I promise. And if we did spam you, you could always say unsubscribe or something. So, pretty low key. But also on the back of it, you can check what you're interested in, or maybe let us know you have a prayer request or a testimony, something you'd like to share. You can fill these things out. Same spot offering goes on the side of the sanctuary. You can just slip that right in there and we'll get in touch with you. So, we'd love to get to know you better and see how we can connect you into the family of God here. But without further ado, we have our final message in our At the Movies series here, and we're going to hear from Pastor Nathan, so let's give him a warm welcome as he comes up.
Thanks, Matt. Good morning, everybody. Great to see you. Thank you so much. It's great to see you. This is our last message in the series At the Movies, and the movie today is the one on the far left there. It's a Star Wars movie called Rogue One, A Star Wars Story. And if you're wondering what this is all about, if you're just joining us today, we're taking some time for some summer fun and looking at how some of the greatest stories of our time, and movies really are the greatest stories that grip people's hearts and minds. They're not the greatest story, that's for sure, but they're the greatest stories that get people's attention and how they point to important truths. And I read it last week, and I love this perspective that C.S. Lewis, the great Christian writer and apologist, had, that the stories and myths of different cultures throughout the ages are shadows. They are shadows of eternal truths. They have a glimpse of truth, but they're living in the shadows, and the light of God's word sheds light and helps us to see the larger or the right truth. And we're going to look at how this story today points to an important truth in Scripture. How many of you have seen Star Wars Rogue One? Okay, a good number. This movie in our home is both loved and hated, and by depending on the person, and I won't say why, because some of you haven't seen it. And so, well, let me see. How many of you have not seen it? Okay, don't worry, you still belong here this morning, and we're glad you're here. It's okay. I won't say why, but it has a theme that I want to hit on that isn't talked about very much, and I shouldn't say that. It needs to be talked about more in the life of discipleship as a follower of Jesus. But let's get into the story a little bit. Our first clip is the trailer of the movie, just to give you a sense of what this story is about. And let's go ahead and have that trailer.
The world is coming undone. Imperial flags reign across the galaxy.
Can you be trusted without your shackles?
Let's just get this over with, shall we?
We have a mission for you. A major weapons test is imminent. We need to know how to destroy it.
If you're really doing this, I want to help.
Good.
Good. I've been recruiting for the Rebellion for a long time.
We destroyed our home! I fight the Empire now.
I fear nothing. All is as the Force wills it.
The captain says you are a friend. I will not kill you.
Thanks.
dictatorial power that is seeking to take over the galaxy. And in the tyranny and force that they use, they have developed, and if you know anything about Star Wars, one of the staples of the story of Star Wars is the Death Star. And it's a gigantic death machine that is the size of a small moon that will be used to enforce their rule and destroy enemies with the ability to literally destroy planets with that gigantic thing you saw in the air there. And in this story, we're introduced to a band of rebels who rise up to seek to put a stop to it, a small band of rebels. And so it has the makings of a great story. And by the way, I personally, you may not agree with me, but I personally think that this is one of the better, newer Star Wars movies that have been made. And interestingly, it was made in 2016. This doesn't have a lot to do with the message, but I just think it's trivia that's worth it. It was made in 2016, but where it takes place in the story of Star Wars, the sequel to the part of the story that comes after this was made in 1977. The very first Star Wars film actually takes place immediately after the story. So if I lost you already, I'll just leave it at that. I don't want to lose you anymore. But the title of today's message is Faith to Follow, Rogue One and the High Cost of the Christian Life. And if you're familiar with Star Wars, you know that one of the central themes of Star Wars is the matter of faith and belief that there's more to life and there's more to the universe than meets the eye. How many of you know what I'm talking about? It really is a matter of faith in Star Wars, and that faith is what in the Star Wars universe is in what we call the Force. And the Force in Star Wars is an impersonal power that connects everything in the universe and is the reason that there is life in the world and that there are living things. And the writer of Star Wars, the original writer, the best writer of Star Wars, George Lucas, he drew from Christianity and from a number of other belief systems on purpose to bring in and highlight this element of faith and that there is more to life and that there is something that has connected everything and given rise to the experience of living. And as a believer in God and the Word, his Word, the Bible, and in Jesus, we know that the truth of what that force is God himself, and he is not impersonal. And he loves people, and he loves you, and he loves me, and he has a plan for our lives, and he is the one that has animated everything that lives in the universe. But you know, it really is about faith, this story, and it's about, in part, people who believe and people who don't believe. There are some who are skeptics and discount and even joke and make fun of those that believe. And then there are those that believe and they orient their life around this and they learn how to live and to flow in what they believe is the Force. And it's interesting that part of the story that holds Star Wars together is that some of the most important characters are those who believe. And you know, in the Christian life and in the Christian faith, we believe in a God we cannot see. We believe in his word that has been given to his prophets and given to his church and to the apostles. And we believe that he is active in the world today and that he has animated his created universe with the mystery of life and that he has an ultimate plan to restore it and bring it back to the order that he designed it to be. How many of you know that that's true? That's the arc of the story of the Bible. And without really realizing it to that extent, George Lucas really captured that arc that eventually things will be brought back to order. And the story of the Bible is that God is working things out according to his plans. And you know, faith is something that occurs to us through a number of ways and a number of means, and I would love to get into a study of faith itself this morning, but I wouldn't have the time to get to the message that the theme that comes out of this particular movie. But faith is something that comes to us through teaching, through observation, and ultimately through the hearing of the word of Scripture. And the Bible says that that kind of faith, when it begins in the heart, is what God gives at the hearing of his word. Many people have faith on a kind of basic or nominal level. and they know that there must be a God, and they look at the world, and they look at the wonder of human life and the biology of the natural world, and they know there must be a God. But what the Bible, what we could call saving faith, comes to us as God illuminates his word. And you know, Paul said to the Colossian church about the importance of them growing in faith. Faith is not a passive thing. It begins by the Spirit of God in our heart at the hearing, but it's not a passive thing. It's something that we need to grow in. And he said to Colossians in chapter 2, "So then, just as you received Christ Jesus as Lord, continue to live your lives in him, rooted and built up in him, strengthened in the faith as you were taught, and overflowing with thankfulness." Paul knew that people need to be strengthened in their faith. And God can use anything in our lives to strengthen our faith. He will use miracles. He will use the testimonies of other people. And he will use difficulties and even trials in our lives that we go through to teach us how to hold on to him and to be strengthened in the faith. And you know, the thing about faith in God is that what really, it rightly is the focus, that faith really has to do with the gift of God in Jesus Christ, that when I believed on the Lord Jesus, I received his gift of eternal life and salvation and the forgiveness of sin. And God gave me, God gives, he's a giver, and by faith we receive so much from God. But there's a side of faith that we need to understand, that it's not all just receiving, there is also giving on our part. And really what it comes down to is that in the Christian life, there is a great cost, and the cost is your life. God wants you to give your life back to him in such a way that you become totally surrendered to God, and totally submitted to him, and totally aligned with his will as you come to know it through his word and how he moves in your life. And as you come to understand the teachings and truths of the Bible, ultimately the Christian life, you know, it should be said that what God gives us is so much greater and so far outweighs what we could ever give back to him, and yet he calls us in the life of faith to give back to him our very lives in surrender, that he could have his way and he could do with us what he would like to do. And I just want to say again, he will give you back so much more than you could ever give, even of your very life. Jesus said this in Luke chapter 9. Then he said to them all, "Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross daily and follow me. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it, but whoever loses their life for me will save it." Jesus said, whoever wants to save their life, whoever wants to hold on to their life that they have unto themselves and their own, is ultimately going to lose it. This is radical. And if you really want to find your life, you have to lose it in me. And Jesus was so clear here. If you want to follow me, you're going to have, and there are some other teachings, and we're going to look at a few of them. You're going to have to go through a death experience. You're going to have to, Jesus said, pick up your cross, and he related it to his own life. You're going to have to experience a death to the way you are living your life, and you can no longer live your life your way. Life your way has to be done away with for my sake, so you can learn how to live life my way. This is the call of the Christian life. And you know, speaking of doing life my way, this is what is natural to us. What's natural to me and my feelings as a human being, and I've been walking with the Lord for many years and experienced his presence and seen him do so many things, and I'm just so convinced in the truth of his word, beyond convinced in the truth of Christianity and the change that has taken place in my life. And yet still when I wake up in the morning, if I just live my life and lead myself according to my natural feelings, I'm going to want to do life my way. I'm going to want to get my way. I'm going to want to find fulfillment my way in what pleases my wants and desires only. And speaking of that, in this next clip in Star Wars, part of the story here is the story of the heroine Jyn Erso, the young lady you saw in the trailer, and she's one of the central figures. And the story begins with Jyn very focused on looking out for number one, just taking care of herself and trying to survive and not wanting to invest her life in others, because life is difficult enough on its own, and there's enough threats to her, and she's gotten herself in trouble, and she's been in danger, and she really just wants to be all about herself. And this is picked up in this next clip when she meets a very peculiar character, and I'll explain a little more after the clip. So why don't we watch the second clip here. Maybe you could lower the lights a little bit when the...
Jyn! Is it really you? I can't believe it.
Must be quite a surprise.
Are we not... still friends?
The last time I saw you, you gave me a knife and loaded blaster and told me to wait in a bunker till daylight.
I knew you were safe.
You left me behind.
You were already the best soldier in my cadre.
I was 16.
I was protecting you.
You dumped me.
You were the daughter of an Imperial science officer. People were starting to figure that out. People who wanted to use you as a
a lot of suffering, and she's been sent out of obligation because she was rescued to this individual who has become like a radical, and you heard him say, you care not about the cause, and the cause is to resist the empire and its tyrannical power. And she says a very interesting thing. She said, it doesn't matter if you don't look up to see the flags of the empire. And she really just wanted to do what she was obligated to do, and then she wanted to get out and get back to living life, protecting self and looking out for number one. And you see in the face of the other character, his last name is Saw, you see in his face that he is stunned, that she's unwilling and unable to recognize the magnitude of the purpose that the rebels have, and that the dangers there are to the galaxy and the need for people to fight back. And so he hopes that he can do something to get her to be more open to giving her life outside of herself to the greater good, which is restoring the galaxy. And you know, it's interesting. According to the Bible, Jin is like all of us in our natural state. In our natural state, our innate orientation is to look out for number one and to live like I feel naturally and to seek to satisfy my desires and make my aim the fulfillment of my own life according to my way. That is what the Bible teaches is our natural state, the way we are born. And it's not that all of the desires we have are wrong or all of the wants we have in life and the hopes and the dreams. It's that when those desires begin to run our lives, apart from being surrendered to the Lord and his purpose, and within the teachings and the safe boundaries of his word, what happens is our lives become overtaken by desire and we begin to live our lives swayed away from what we were made for. And our lives run amok and we begin to be taken over by our desires, and it takes us further and further away from the purposes of the Lord, towards selfishness and self-centered living. And ultimately, if we were to live in that path, apart from submission to the Lord Jesus, it would take us to destruction. You know, Paul said this to the Galatian church: I have been crucified with Christ. Listen to his radical perspective on this. I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Paul used the imagery in the story of Jesus and what Jesus did for us, and he applied it to his own life, and he entered in and said, my life is called, as a follower of Jesus, I'm called to enter into his experience, and my life is now crucified and dead in Christ. Was he physically dead? No, he was standing there, and he was writing to the church, and he had ministered to the people of the Galatian church. But he was saying, when it comes to my own life, my way in Christ, I'm no longer alive like that. I live a new life in Jesus according to his way. And you know, there's something that we can call the great paradox of Christianity. Two opposites that seem to be completely opposed to each other. This is the great paradox of the Christian life. In order to truly live, you have to die. This is one of the great truths of Christianity, and it is a part of the call of a disciple. And ultimately, it is true of our bodily lives. In order to truly enter into fully what God has prepared for us, according to the teachings of the Bible, we will have to die physically unless the Lord returns and enter into his presence apart from this body. And then when he returns at the second coming and we receive our resurrection body, we will enter into the life of glory and resurrection life. But it is also true in our life now, and it is a death and a dying to the self-willed life and the self-directed life and the self-focused life. It's our natural state, and God wants us to do away with that. In order to truly live, we have to die. And you know, the first key I want to bring to you out of the scripture and this story in the background is that following Jesus is a journey of dying to self so we can experience new life through him. I don't know about you, but I don't like dying experiences. I don't like pain. I don't like feeling trouble and difficulty. I don't like suffering of any kind. I don't like loss in my life. I don't like losses of any kind, big losses and small losses. And I've experienced some big losses in my life, and I've experienced even little ones that really got to me. And many of you have experienced major losses in your life, and you know what it's like to hurt. And of course you wouldn't want to voluntarily be a part of another painful experience. And yet there's this paradox in the teachings of Scripture and in the Christian life that to truly experience the fullness of what Jesus wants to give to you and me, there are going to have to be some dying experiences where who we are in our natural state is dying off more and more. So we're living totally surrendered to the Lord. You know, a few truths about this. We were already spiritually dead because of sin. And before we were thinking about these things, before we knew about them, the Bible teaches that we were in our spiritual state, we were dead. because of sin. Ephesians 2, 1-5. As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our flesh and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature deserving of wrath. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. And you know, we need to die to sin in our old self. What does it mean to, in order to truly live, we have to die? What kind of dying am I talking about? We need to die to sin and our old self. And one of the turning points of the Christian life is when we turn away from what the Bible calls sin and we begin to live in God's ways and live in righteousness and live according to the morals and the teachings of the Bible. And you know, that's not easy for people. Some sins and some lifestyles are a part of their very nature and their makeup. And the Bible calls us to turn away from anything that is not pleasing to the Lord. And a part of following Jesus is dying to sin. And what the Bible says in this passage is our old self. Ephesians 4, you're going to notice all three of these passages I have in these points here from Paul's letter to the Ephesians. And you can ask, well, what is that letter about? It's about a lot of things, and it's definitely about dying in Christ so that we can experience the fullness of his life. So I tell you this and insist on it in the Lord, that you must no longer live as the Gentiles do. In the futility of their thinking, they are darkened in their understanding and separated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to the hardening of their hearts. Having lost all sensitivity, they have given themselves over to sensuality so as to indulge in every kind of impurity, and they are full of greed. That, however, is not the way of life you learned when you heard about Christ and were taught in him in accordance with the truth that is in Jesus. You were taught, with regard to your former way of life, to put off your old self. You see, there it is. To put off your old self, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires, to be made new in the attitude of your minds, and to put on the new self, created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. We need to die to sin in our old self. You know, that's an active thing. There are some things in the Christian life when it comes to dying in Christ, in his cross, that are active, where we have to willfully come to God and turn away from things that we find out are not pleasing to him, and that is that process of dying to sin. There are also some things that can be passive, both active and passive, and I have found this in my own life when it comes to the need to die to self-centered living. How many of you know that it is in our natural self to live in a self-centered way? How many of you know that that's true? Who would say, yeah, I've been there before. Oh my goodness, I've been there. In my natural self, I'm self-centered, and the scriptures call us as a follower of Jesus to die to self-centered. What is self-centered living? It's when I just make my life about me, myself, and I, in my pursuits, and my happiness. And there's a very clear word in scripture, and it is taken from Jesus' life, and Paul used his life as an example. And he said here a little later in his letter to the Ephesians, follow God's example, therefore, as dearly loved children, and walk in the way of love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. It's the way of love. The Bible calls us to walk in the way of love. We receive love from God, an unconditional love, and we are to express that same love to others. And one of the ways we do that is to give ourselves and often give up of ourselves in the love of God for the good of others. And you know, these kinds of dying experiences can be very painful. You know, to give up preferences and to experience loss. bosses, you know, some of these are active and some of these are passive. And what I mean by that is some dying experiences as we follow Jesus weren't because of any choices that we made. They were circumstances and seasons that came into our lives. And when I say passive, I mean they happened to us. And yet the Lord invites us and calls us to come to Him even in the midst of our pain. And the way that God works is He will make good out of anything. I don't believe that He sends all of the things that cause us to experience dying to self, but I know He will use all of the things that cause us to experience dying to self. You know, I have a tree in our front yard. We have a tree. I tend to be possessive of my garden plants, so I said, I have a tree. We have a tree. It's not my house. It's our house. It's God's house. And in our front yard, we have like a 200-year-old sugar maple, and it's gigantic, and it basically almost shades the entire yard. And under that maple is a beautiful red-flowering dogwood. And it flowered only the first year we were in that house. And it had beautiful pinkish-red flowers. And the shade of this massive maple tree has now blocked it out to the point that it will no longer flower because it doesn't get any more sun. And last year, a storm came and broke off a gigantic branch from a nearby tree that opened up some light so that in the middle of the day, direct beams of the sunlight would make it to this tree. And this spring, I was so excited after going through all the damage that that tree branch did to our home and all of those kinds of things and insurance and all of that. I looked and I saw that the sun was shining on the dogwood. And this year, I was anticipating that beautiful flowers would once again be on that dogwood. And you know what happened? A Western New York drought happened this summer. And as I was watching for flowers, I noticed in the last few weeks the tree began to shrivel and the leaves began to turn brown, and most of them have now either totally browned and blackened or have fallen off of the branches. And the tree's not dead, it's just gone dormant because of the severity of the dryness that we have had. And you know, that tree is going through a season of difficulty. I don't think trees have feelings. Well, I don't know. I don't know if they have feelings, but I don't think they do. That was a joke. But that tree is going through a difficult season, and it's not able to reach its potential. It's not able to show forth what it was created for, and yet we know that seasons will change and a new day will come when it is no longer so severely dry and so stressed by what is happening around it. And you know, sometimes passively things happen to us and we go through shriveling experiences and it feels like dying inside of us. And we say, God, why are you letting this happen to me? This hurts, Lord. Have you ever prayed that kind of prayer before? Lord, this hurts. And we wonder why a good and loving God would let us go through things. And again, I don't believe that He sends all of those things. I do know that He allows them. And I do know that those who look to Him and stay knit to Him, like that first scripture we read, to be rooted and built up in Him so that our faith will be strengthened, that He will use those things in our lives to teach us how to live again in Him and how to live the new life in the power of His Spirit rather than just in our own ways, in our own power. But you know, dying experiences can be painful, and sometimes the passive ones that we didn't see coming and we had no choice in can be some of the most painful. There are losses, and there are hurts that occur, and people cause hurts in our lives. And you know, different seasons come, and there are losses of personal desires and dreams. It doesn't mean that we have to forever just throw them away, but there can be losses of things that are so dear to us, and yet we encounter the Lord in the midst of those, calling us to continue to look to Him and to stick to Him and hold on to Him and trust Him. You know, sometimes dying experiences are blows to our pride and our sense of self. And God would call us to pick up our cross, the instrument of death, and die to that part of us that wants to get what is due us and wants to have our rights and demand what we know others owe us. And maybe it's our pride that is being killed off. Maybe there's something in us that wants to be honored, and yet we feel dishonored. Maybe we want to be counted in and included, and there's been an experience where we feel forgotten. I want to say to you this morning, the Lord has not left you in those things. I don't know why he lets us go through them, but he calls us to stick with him so that we can begin to experience his grace and strength. And when I finish the message this morning in a few moments, that's what I'm going to be praying for us this morning, that we will be strengthened by God because he lets us go through things. And you know, some of these dying experiences aren't going to happen unless we're active. And by that I mean unless we choose, unless we willfully choose to go in the direction and to look to Jesus and to let go of those things that we want and the way that we wish it would go. And we just look unto the Lord and we release it into his hands and we give up. And sometimes we let other people get their way. And I'm not talking about situations where there's abuse, but where there are different things that go on in relationships and patterns where you know you could push for your way, and it may even be your right, it may even be owed to you, but in that situation, to do that, you would be robbing yourself and the other person of the experience where they can begin to receive from God as you let go and you begin to look unto the Lord and peace comes into the situation. And you know, some of these are active, and God knows how to get into your heart and your mind as you look to him and as you stay in your word. God knows how to get through to you, to begin to speak to you, that he wants to strengthen you, even though he also wants you to make a choice that is the opposite of what your feelings tell you. How many of you are with me? In this last clip, Jin has changed her mind and changed the direction of her life, and she's fully devoted to the cause, this great cause, even ahead of where some of the others are around her. And I want you just to see this clip to see how radically she has shifted the focus of her life to be more than just her, to be about more than just herself. Let's watch this last clip.
We must scatter the fleet. We have no recourse but to surrender.
Are we really talking about disbanding something that we've worked so hard to create?
We can't just give in!
We joined an alliance, not a suicide pact.
We've only now managed to gather our forces.
Gather our forces? General Draven's already blown up an Imperial base.
A decision needed to be made.
If it's war you want, you'll fight alone.
If that's how it's going, why have an alliance at all?
If she's telling the truth, we need to act now.
Counselors, please.
It is simple. The Empire has the means of mass destruction. The Rebellion does not.
A Death Star? This is nonsense.
What reason would my father have to lie? What benefit would it bring him?
To lure our forces into a final battle, to destroy us once and for all.
Risk everything. Based on what? The testimony of a criminal. The dying words of her father, an Imperial scientist.
Oh, don't forget the Imperial pilot.
My father gave his life so that we may have a chance to defeat this.
So you've told us.
If the Empire has this kind of power, what chance do we have?
What chance do we have? The question is, what choice? Run, hide, plead for mercy, scatter your forces. You give way to an enemy this evil with this much power, and you condemn the galaxy to an eternity of submission. The time to fight is now.
Yes.
Every moment you waste is another step closer to the ashes of Jeddah. Send your best troops to Scarif. Send the rebel fleet if you have to. You need to capture the Death Star plans if there's any hope of destroying it.
You're asking us to invade an Imperial installation based on nothing but hope. Rebellions are built on hope.
Okay, I'd like to keep watching it because from here it gets really good. It gets really, really good. I kind of forgot for a second I was in church. So Jin has radically changed. And it's not a happy reason why. She saw the destruction that the Death Star can bring to an entire planet. And she wants to give her life and the direction of her life to finding those secret plans that her father had set out as a way to destroy the Death Star. And the threat is so great that the greatest generals in the rebellion, many of them are unwilling to take that risk. And this is a Star Wars story, and she's a heroine. And so her courage and inspires others, and she builds a band of people that gather around her. And in the rest of the story, great heroes are born and great sacrifices are made. And you know, it was because of the cause and because of the power of evil, she realized my life needs to be more than just me. And she needed to be willing to take great risks and set aside protecting herself and focusing on herself. And she needed to give herself to something that was much bigger than herself. How many of you know that's easy to preach from that? The great cause is the greatest cause there would ever be is the cause of Christ. And that Jesus has come into the world to offer salvation to everyone who will believe. And that if people don't believe, if people don't hear the message of Jesus, they will not be rescued. They will be taken by darkness ultimately. And God has called his church to join with him, to partner with him, and to go out into the world and be witnesses for him. But one of the ways that he forms us and prepares us is by calling us to die in our life as we've known it only unto ourselves and offer it back to him. There's a theological word, and maybe you'll want to write this down if you're a note taker, because I don't have it on the screen. But that whole paradox of needing to die in order to truly live, one of the ways that that is said is what God calls us to is the cruciform life. The cruciform life is a life that has become shaped by the cross of Jesus, by dying experiences, but on the other side of those dying experiences, experiencing greater levels of the power of the Holy Spirit and the grace of God, giving us joy and giving us strength. And you know, I want to finish with this here. The second key is that following Jesus is a bit about becoming like him and laying down his life for others. And you know, so much of the sacrifice and the cost to ourselves in following Jesus is going to have to do with our relationships with other people. And Jesus uses his own life as an example in John 15 when he said this to his disciples. My command is this, love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this. Why don't you read this out loud with me, this last part? To lay down one's life for one's friends. The greatest expression of love is preferring another person's good over your own and being willing to sacrifice what you want for the betterment of another person. And you know, we might quickly go to thinking in terms of hero stories and paying the ultimate price. And you know, that might be. Maybe you will be called in your life to actually give of your own life to protect another person. And as a father, I remember long ago, as a husband and then a father, long ago, realizing there was a readiness in me to give my life to protect the people that I love. But you know, most of the time, it's not the ultimate price that we're called to pay. Where our discipleship in Jesus and our conforming our lives unto his cross shows up most of the time is in the little sacrifices, like time and activities and choices and rights and maybe demands. When we know we could push for our way, we know that we could grab and just keep grasping to what we want, and that maybe eventually we'll wear the other person down, or maybe eventually they'll give up, or we'll win, or we'll come out with a better argument, whatever it might be. But in doing that, we are missing an opportunity to demonstrate the love of God in laying down our side so that they can have what betters their lives, even if it means costing us our rights at times. You know, sometimes some of the biggest moments of growing in the Lord has been when I have stopped myself from seeking what I want. And I feel the loss. I feel the blow. I feel the sting of sacrifice. And I surrender that to the Lord, and I begin to experience the grace of God in my life as his cross is worked out in me. Would you stand with me this morning? I want to give you a moment to respond to the Lord's word. want you to just ask this question. How might God be asking me to die to self right now? Is there something I'm wanting, something I'm striving for that I'm realizing is not pleasing to the Lord? If it's not pleasing to the Lord, if you're beginning to recognize it's not pleasing to the Lord, to pursue that thing is sin. And if you have questions about that and you're not sure if it's okay, you're not sure if pursuing that thing is acceptable to the Lord or is the right thing to do, please ask a leader in the church. Ask someone who you know that has walked with God for years. Have a conversation. What am I to make of this? And I have this desire or this thing, and I'm not sure. I'm starting to wonder if it's the right thing and if it's okay and it's acceptable to the Lord. Paul told us to find out what pleases the Lord, and if it's not pleasing to him, to continue to pursue that thing is sin. And God calls us to turn away from those things. And that's a part of the cross in our lives. It's a part of the dying. How might God be asking me? Ask yourself this question this morning. How might he be asking me to lay down my life for my friends or my family right now? Are there wants that I'm working towards? Are there ways that I have of getting my preferences and my take on things and how I want things to go, when the greater love would be to turn towards the preference of the other person? Some of you this morning are peace and tranquility in your relationship. Some of you, you're having that great gift of domestic tranquility. And some of you this morning, there may be heartache going on. There may be difficulty. There may be tussling and quiet anger residing in your heart. And I want to speak to your heart this morning with the Holy Spirit here to help me, that if God is calling you to lay something down so that the preference of the other person would have way, and so that you can show the love of Jesus to that other person, this morning I want to challenge you in the presence of the Lord to say yes to him and to let it go. Am I willing to let go of my preferences to show the love of Jesus to another person? Am I willing to suffer for the sake of the name of Jesus when it comes to making him known? Am I willing to suffer the rejection and maybe the jokes at work or at school if I let it be known that I'm a follower of Jesus? Am I willing to endure his cross in that area of my emotions and relationship? In order to truly live in God, we have to die. And so God brings us to places where we are asked to lay it down, to let it go, to bring the pain to him, to bring the anxieties to him, and to look to him who is able to help us. He is our helper in time of need. The thing about the Lord is he doesn't keep us from times of need, but he is our helper, the Bible says, in our times of need. And this morning, what he would say to you if you're in one of those places is to look to him in your time of need. And so, Lord, we look to you. You're the one that helps, and it's a help that no one else can give us, God. You're the one, the lover of our souls. You're the one that knows the innermost places of our hearts, and you can touch us there, Lord. And so today I pray over these precious people, those that are wrestling, those that are struggling, those that are walking through pain. Lord, would you meet them today and give them the strength and the grace that they need to stand up and to trust you and to know the joy of the Lord in the middle of the storm and to know faith, hope, and love, not knowing what's going to come out of the situation, but knowing that you are the same yesterday, today, and forever. And I pray that strength upon them and that blessing upon them in the name of Jesus. Lord, build hope in our hearts. Lord, we can trust that you're going to accomplish your will. You're not going to leave us out hung to dry. Lord, you're not going to leave us out there some way to where to fade away. You're going to be faithful to those who follow you to accomplish every part of your will for our lives. And so, Lord, we trust you. We want to join with you, Jesus, in your cause. We want to be a part of what you're doing in the land, Lord. Life is so much more than just me. Oh, God, would you keep me from being just about me, but be willing to come to that place of the cross and die so that I can stand up with the supernatural life of the Spirit of God driving me. And I choose that today, Lord. We choose that. Why don't you say that to the Lord this morning in your own way? We choose that, Lord. We choose you and the life in the Spirit today. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. I want to open up the front area this morning as I'm getting ready to release the service, and we're going to have some ministry time. And Mark and Louise, if you're available, if you could come for ministry, and Emily, if you could be here to minister. And I want to just open it up right now, and I'm about to close the service. If you want to come forward to receive ministry today, we're going to stay here after the service. We want to pray with you. We want to speak over you. We can pray with whatever you're going through. If you don't have a relationship with the Lord, or maybe you've fallen away from the Lord and you want to come back to Jesus today and you want to make a fresh commitment, we would love to join with you and share in that moment and pray with you in a special moment of coming back to the Lord. Would you lift your hands to the Lord this morning? I just want to pray a blessing as I end the service. We lift our hands as an attitude and posture of receiving from God and blessing the Lord. Lord, with our hands raised, we look unto you, and I thank you for your presence here. Thank you for your word, God. Thank you for using movies to speak important things. I thank you for these people. I thank you for the faith that is represented in this room. Thank you for the grace that is totally sufficient for every single situation represented in this room. And I pray your blessing upon your people today, that they would go with faith. They would have hope in you, that their trust would be strengthened as they head out these doors into this new week. And all God's people said, amen, amen. In the name of the Lord Jesus, bless you today as you go. Hey, we'd love to have you join with us in a little bit. I'll be heading down to Lima to the Sunday Fun Day. We'd love to meet you there, and I hope you have a great week.